Well, as newscasters always say, here we go. I am going to take you on a nice flat earth walk. We'll go up a new road today. To all the folks that watched my last live flat walk, thank you for tuning in. Here's a plum tree. Plum trees are coming back pretty good. The old truck. Let's see, what's Yahweh got me thinking today? Yeah, I guess I'll just start out. Today is the day Yahweh has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is a good day. It's sunny. It's beautiful. Feeling healthy. So good just to be healthy, you know. We take so much for granted. Just a day, you know, just to be healthy. I mean, all you folks that are healthy, you know, that could be gone any moment. Everybody rides in cars these days. One second, you don't know, you know. People, they say statistically, people die within a few miles of their home. And generally, in a car wreck. So, you never know, you know, how long you have or whatever. So it's good to always be thankful. Enjoy your health if you have it. Because be gone any moment. These trees with the orange tags are all fruit trees. I planted, they're not doing too good because there's a lot of tall growth all around here. This is a hand-built road that did not exist. Built by me. It's kind of crazy to build your own road, but it's amazing to think this wasn't even a path once. This is a cow fence. Keep the cows out. Trap the bears in. It's on right now. If you saw my last video, it's kind of a miracle happened. I climbed underneath the cow electric fence, which my husband says is very, very, very extremely hot. Well, like very much just wake you right up. Right now. And I accidentally, I think, knocked up against it, you know, trying to get underneath it during the last bit, and I felt nothing. So that was pretty interesting afterthought. Hell. Yeah. Be thankful. Be thankful if you have good health. If you have bad health, like I was talking about, I've been through a lot of health challenges. I'm really thankful for them because, you know, I know what it's like to be like 90 years old, you know. When you could barely walk and stuff, and I, you know, you don't really know what it's like. You think people are lazy, or you know, so many people have health concerns and stuff, and you look at them and you think, oh, come on, you know, get together, or quit complaining and stuff. And some people are just complainers, and, you know, like fibromyalgia or whatever, you know, they got some excuse to not do anything or receive a government check or, but, you know, there are people that really are, you know, having a very hard, there's a nice palm tree, it's really big. It's like over two stories tall there. That really do have a very hard time, and, you know, have sympathy. I have sympathy now as a result of struggles I've had. I'm glad that I've been through struggles, because it's like in Isaiah where, you know, where it foretells of coming of Christ, Isaiah 52 and 53. I am a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. And it goes on to describe the whole scenario that went down with the cross. An amazing, amazing prophecy there in Isaiah. But, yeah, Yeshua knows our hardships, and he's not so far from us that, you know, that so far removed from our troubles that he can't relate to. That's why Yahweh came in the flesh to live amongst us, because, you know, he was so righteous, and he didn't want anybody to have the excuse. Well, there's many reasons, of course, but he didn't want anybody to have the mental excuse, well, Yahweh Father doesn't know what it's like down here, you know, he put us through hell, let all these bad things, and, you know, oh gosh, you know, he lives in a cloud and everything's wonderful, and, you know, he has no clue. It's like, well, you can't say that. He came and lived amongst us, our fallen world, and every single second of his life, he was good. Every single second. I mean, we all know, you know, we've all heard that Yeshua never sinned. But when you think that every single second was only righteousness, only goodness, and he suffered, you know, just like all of us will. We will. It's not a matter of will you suffer. We all will. We all suffer, you know, from famous actors and politicians and Zionist pigs. We all suffer, you know, even the rich, you know, I mean, I've known some very rich and famous people, my heart always went, seriously, honestly, my heart always, I guess that's why I've hung out with a lot of rich and powerful people, is my heart went out to them, because when you're that in that position, you don't really know that people are okay. we're recording again. Sorry about that. I get shut off. Yeah. Yeah, people in power are, you know, you don't know. Like I knew Ripper Phoenix, the actor, famous child actor and teen actor and stuff. Friend of Johnny Depp and in many movies. My Own Private Idaho was one of them. But I knew him personally. You know, he was a friend of mine. And, he had some hard times. He didn't feel like he could trust anyone. And I treated him really pretty bad. You know, I was young. And I treated him pretty bad. He was kind of attracted to me, and, you know, and but I'd always shove him off, you know, just kind of like, you're Johnny Depp, you know, or, I mean, you're River Phoenix, and, you know, I'm not just gonna, like, be your girlfriend or something just because, you know, you're powerful. But, you know, it wasn't long after that that he died. And the poor guy, you know, he used to walk around in my town dressed up like a hobo. Because he wanted people just to take him as a human being. He actually got a job as a fry chef, not because he needed it. That's where we became friends. Is I had a little shop and around the corner where they had vegetarian food. He got a job as a fry chef, and in between doing major motion pictures, he would go work in this little shop and try to be human. You know, try to, because he was a child star all of his life. And he just wanted to be liked for being a human and be you know, feel like he could be around people that trust him. And I felt like I was doing him a favor by not being, like, his fan, you know, just trying to keep it real and, like, you know, be nice to him, but not, like, be his girlfriend or anything, you know, just because I was a Christian. I did believe, and I wanted to take that I was moving in on his glory or anything. Then I felt really bad when he died, you know, and he died. I think he was drugged. Johnny Depp's club, the Viper, the snake. I think it was a, you know, personally, a celebrity killing to honor Satan. Like so many things are. You know, the sacrifice, like they do with Marilyn Monroe and all these people who suddenly died. But, yeah, people like that, you never know. I mean, I bring up famous people and stuff, not just to drop names. I could do that all day until the cows come home. Yahweh has allowed me to walk amongst a very well-balanced group of humans in my time. Very rich and extremely poor. You know, I've jumped trains, I've hung out with hobos, I've hitchhiked. I've had absolutely nothing. I walked across the country a number of times in nothing but a white robe, barefoot, with no money, you know, street preaching, sharing the gospel, living in faith. Oh, I don't think a person needs to do that. I don't think you need to do that. I wouldn't want to do that right now. But I'd do it. Maybe I'd do it, you know. I'm just older. It's harder to jump a train when you get older. Maybe if my back is healed and just haven't got all my muscles back yet. But back to my subject. Just because somebody's rich and famous doesn't mean they're any better off than the bum, and the bum any worse off than the rich and famous. And it's like in the Bible, you know, you tell the rich guy, you know, come sit up here, you know, brother, you know, sit at the front of the table, and the poor guy, put him in the back of the church. Now, you don't know. That poor guy might very well be, and from my experience, often is the bum on the street. You know, might be an angel. Angel of Yahweh. You don't know. Yeshua walked amongst us. He was not fancy or anything. Just was a common man. But we all need to be thankful in our health, thankful when we have no health, thankful to just be given a chance to live. You know, like Paul said, in all things, you know, I've learned to be content in all things. That's my goal. I don't care for happiness. Happiness is like, ooh, I got a new thing. Woohoo, exciting. You know, yeah, well, eventually you'll get bored with the new thing. Yeah, even if it is great. I mean, I love my guitars and things fully appreciate them, probably more than the day I got them, every day that I have them. But they don't keep you happy. You can appreciate things, and that doesn't mean they keep you happy, kind of like people. You know, you might keep them, but they don't keep you happy. So I think that higher calling is contentment than the happiness. Happiness is fleeting, and it comes and it goes, and it should be that way. Or, you know, how would you be happy if you never were not happy? But some people are like, ooh, easy. But no, happiness is relative to everything. It's an extreme of everything. Contentment is the balance of realizing that good and bad, rich and poor, it's all to the glory of Yahweh eventually. You know, I will work all things for His glory. You know, all things work together for Him who loves Yahweh. For the person who loves Yahweh, you know, that's the, you know, if you love Yahweh, then all things work together for good. If you don't, it's going to seem like, you know, why is this happening? And we all go through that, you know, even the best of us. It's like, why is this happening to me? The best people have the worst things happen generally. Just because you're a Christian, people become Christians, they think, ooh, you know, I'm being good now, you know, and all these good things are going to happen for me. No, it's not like karma or anything like that, you know, it's like all of a sudden you have got rid of all your bad karma points, so you know, that's why it's so much better than the idea of karma. You know, to be a believer of the true scripture, of the true word, is because wouldn't that be the way my camera would shut off right as I'm praying. That's the demons for you. Yeah. I think that, Yahweh is good. And I thank you, Yahweh. Thank you, Yahweh, in Yeshua's name, that you see fit to walk amongst us and offer salvation. I don't want to be a one-trick pony and just teach salvation. Salvation's just the milk. It's the beginning. People get stuck on the beginning. The Bible is so infinitely multifaceted. That's why I learned Hebrew, so I could, in ancient Hebrew, so I could study it directly from the text. I've read the first two books of the Bible straight through in the Hebrew language. And I learned so much in the Hebrew. And people say, oh, the book is corrupt. Well, that's what got me into it. I wanted to see that it wasn't corrupt. That's the amazing thing, is that even though the translations are corrupt, the original text in the original Hebrew, that's why the Bible code works. If one letter was not working right, one letter was wrong, the whole Bible code would be messed up. And Yeshua said, you know, I won't remove a jot or a tittle, and woe unto any man who would, you know, change the words. And, you know, the King James is not perfect, but it has a concordance to it. The Strong's concordance. Use a Strong. Strong's is for the strong. And use the Strong's concordance. It's not perfect either, but it's the best we have. And take those words back and take them to the root words and find out what the word says. And find out for yourself, you know, what is actually going on. We're getting together a truth or site where we're going to break down all these terms to help flat earthers like myself to break down these basic words that we need so dearly to have in the original Hebrew, so we can have a good foundation, like Genesis, you know, a good Genesis to this flat earth movement, that we can build upon a right understanding of these key words, like foundation and earth, and, you know, earth in Hebrew is teretz. It can actually be one of two words, two Hebrew words, so many words like that, you know, you got to go back and they're either in, you know, the implied context also, the sentence structure means a lot in the Hebrew too, you know, what, how you would interpret the word is relative, because I don't want to get too complicated here, but there are no vowels in Hebrew. A lot of the vowels are in ancient Hebrew. There are in modern Hebrew. But in ancient Hebrew, there were no vowels. And no sophits, even, which are the ending of sentences. But it was, the scripture was all one big run-on sentence, basically. Kind of like how I write, one big giant sentence. One huge monologue. It didn't stop. It wasn't separated. But, yeah. I'm trying to hold this camera. Yeah, we need to get to the foundation of the flat earth movement. Figure out the basics worked out. You know, they're there in the Bible. You know, I trust that Yahweh told us everything we need to know, and it's just a matter of reading the letter that He gave us. You know, I come in the fullness of the word, and the fullness of the word is written of me. The word is the inspired, breathed, ruach in Hebrew, breathed word of Yahweh. And Yeshua was that word. He was the word of Yahweh. He was the inspired word. And every word was meaningful. And therefore, any basis for the flat earth movement should be based on the strong foundation of the creator of the flat earth. Not to say, you know, people say flat earth or earth, I mean, here I am on an 8,500 foot mountain. It's obviously not flat, and so that might throw a lot of, that might be a big term that we need to somehow redirect, because right there, socially, it's going to be a big turnoff for a lot of people. It's like, oh, you silly fools, you know. Anybody can see the earth is not flat, you know. It's, where you live, Kansas? But, yeah, we really just need to get back to what the Bible says about these things and trust it and believe it. You don't have to believe something. When it's proven to you, it's proven to you. You don't have to trust it. Trust is the response to having something proven to you. You don't have to try to trust or try to have faith. Things are proven to you. They're proven to you. You know. You know them. They become knowledge. It's, you know, empirical evidence is that which is proven, that you can prove yourself over. That's what science means. You know, it's what can be shown over and over again in various places over and over by repeated experiment and various people without an agenda, you know, to constantly be true. And true science will always reveal the truth. And that's, I mean, everything's converging, you know, as far as quantum physics and all that, you know, micro and macrocosm, you know, nothing, we've been looking for the grand unified theory scientifically for some time now to put together, you know, thermodynamics, gravity, and all this stuff. These things couldn't come together until flat earth was realized. They just wouldn't work. Flat earth, which is, you know, is just kind of English slang for the true creation. True creation is grand unified theory. It brings all these, you know, there's no such thing as gravity. And gravity is grave. It's death. You know, there's no such thing as gravity. It's a theory that was a theory, you know, and it's disproved on a flat earth, on a creation, the true creation. There is no gravity, there's no need, because, you know, we're not hanging to the edge of a ball. So, you know, there we are, you know, all these things are converging now. Science, religion, and those of us, I've seen so. Okay, I think I'm back again. Keep shutting off. Yeah, I think it's timed to 10 minutes. I quit 10 minutes, what it was. But back to flat earth and scripture and science and quantum and rich and famous and poor and all that. It's all coming together. You know, you could be like famous rap star, you could be Bob, or you could be Tila Tequila, or whatever her name is. You could be Johnny Depp. You could be, you know, all these people. You know, Soma Seeds, he's a flat earther, you know. All these people are all coming together, you know, and realizing, waking up, this is the biggest thing that ever happened on Earth. People from all backgrounds and races in this time of civil unrest. They're trying to bring another civil war upon us with new race wars and stuff that they are cooking up for us. They're creating these. You know, it's not us. You know, this stuff is being acted out, you know, and created amongst us to try to get us to fight amongst ourselves. And, you know, there'll always be wars and rumors of wars, you know, until Yeshua returns as king. You know, we're not getting raptured out of here. We're getting, you know, the rapture, you know, the rapture is mostly, you know, is not a word in the Bible. But what people translate to be a rapture in second Corinthians is actually speaking of, you know, rising to meet him when he comes back as king, to rule as king. And we're taken up into the air, it says. Well, air there goes back to the word ruach, which is actually that word inspiration, where we get our word from, and it means spirit, literally, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the word, the air, the true prince of the power of the air, not the false one, Satan, the prince of this world, and this air, but the true air, like heir of a king, is Yeshua, you know. We are co-heirs of all creation with him, and what he has received as Yahweh himself, we shall also, Yahweh wants to give us him. He wants to give us what he has. He wants us, you know, dare I say, to be like him, to be his children. Children are like their parent. And I know that, you know, that might sound awfully Eastern, you know, to become God. Well, no, it's only through humility, be willing to be the child of God. If you're willing to be the child of God, then you're willing to someday become and take on the power and the what we can't even imagine, the ability, but only through righteousness, you know. And who wants to give the car to some bum kid that, you know, I mean, he'll kill himself, you know. He'll kill himself and a bunch of people in the process. You're not just gonna hand over the keys of the Cadillac to some kid who thinks he knows it all. No, you have to prove your humility, your ability to be worthy.